Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Horror PSA presented by Scary Nerd. And as always, we are your hosts. I'm Paul.
I'm Saul.
And I'm Angie.
The following is a public service announcement.
Six friends hire a medium to hold a seance via Zoom during lockdown, but they get far more than they bargained for as things quickly go wrong. We watched 2020's Shudder Original Host.
Yes, we did. A movie about this year, pretty much.
Yes.
if 2020 was its own online seance, this is what would happen.
Yes, if 2020 was an online seance, this is the movie for it. I dig this movie, though. It really takes a whole new approach to the found footage type style, and I felt that it was very true to actually like that kind of setup, that team kind of aspect of it with the Zoom and like having five different people on there.
Yeah,
because we all had to get real comfortable with that real quick this year.
Yep.
And I really feel like it does it really well. Like there's a part where they're just going around Teddy's girlfriend's house and he's just like, look at this. It's totally like a kindergartner's first day on like school, on a virtual school, just running around with his iPad showing everybody everything.
That bitch Jenny.
Everything that happened in the movie to me seemed like, you're talking about, it's stuff that we're used to now, because I mean, we have people that teach over the internet now, so it's just, and we have meetings pretty much over the internet with Zoom, so all of that pretty much translated well to this year.
It did, and it translates well in the movie. Like, when I first heard of Host, I was so suspect, because
it sounded dumb.
It did sound dumb.
I mean, admittedly, the premise sounded, like, particularly stupid. Like, what? Online saying, like, that's the dumbest thing ever. But I have to admit, like, the way that they do the exposition, the way that they set everything up, it really works for this movie.
Mm-hmm.
So, after we watched it the first time, I was like, you know what? This is not... So, if anyone hasn't seen the movie, this is what I would say to you. It's not the second coming of Christ in cinema form.
Nothing ever is when it gets hyped.
So go into it. I mean, there's a lot of hype around this movie. There's a lot of buzz around it. I think the originality of everything is really what most of the buzz is about.
Yeah.
And deservedly so. Because, I mean, you know, in working with under the parameters that you have of COVID and everything, and, you know, everyone, like we're saying, you know, everyone was introduced into this whole Zoom internet kind of business world that we have to do everything, literally everything, you know, there are kindergartners, going to school online right now. So it's literally everyone is having to get on Zoom or fucking Teams or just anything like that. So I think it's taking that and it's, you know, kind of updating, you know, a demonic story. It's updating, you know, the whole, well, they did a seance and this, you know, shit happens. It's kind of updating all of those things and putting it into today's context. And I think that, you know, it's creative and fresh, but it's nothing that hasn't been done before.
And
that's what I thought. Overall, the movie to me was okay. I think to me is it, once you had the Paranormal Activity movies come out, to me, it opened up a new door. But with this one, it seemed like it followed every single rule that those had. I give it its credit for the originality of how they filmed it and how it's taking place now. But a lot of the things that I had issue with was a lot of the tropes that the paranormal movies set up.
See, and I think it's so buzzed right now because people all thought it was going to be stupid. Everybody's like, this sounds stupid. And then they watch it and they're like, that's not bad. And so they're like, no, it's good. It's good. And it's just like, it's not, like you said, it's not the second coming of Christ. It is a genuinely good movie that keeps my interest for the whole 57 minutes.
Yeah, I give it credit. It did hold my interest. Like what you said, exactly. It does, like when you hear about what it is, it's like, okay, this is stupid. How are they going to do a seance?
Yeah, I really, when I first heard about it, I thought I gave it the same reaction as I gave that, coronavirus zombie movies that I heard about. I was like, yep, that's what this is. But then after seeing it, I was like, okay.
On the surface, it seems like it's one of those sci-fi cash grab movies. Relevant right now. Just shit it out and get it on the air. Mm-hmm. I mean, it definitely does sound like that. So I think it has the opposite effect, like what you're saying, you know, you don't expect anything from it. So that way, when it does end up being pretty good, you're like, holy crap, like that was way better than I thought.
And I think that's why so many people overhype.
I think transversely, like you need to go in this not believing that it's the greatest movie. Like I said, it's fresh and original take on stuff that's been already done. And it just made it into a form that's more relevant right now. So it's not a sci-fi movie.
No.
So it's definitely not a cheesy piece of crap like you would expect, like that. Yeah. Where I mean, the coronavirus zombies are coming, like all that kind of shit.
Exactly.
What was it? The minks are coming back alive now?
Apparently. The minks got into the stuff that was underneath the ground, and now they're rising to stuffy
minks. The reanimated minks from the earth jizz.
They got all that discharge all over them. Now they're awake again, apparently. What else will this year do to us?
We still got a whole month to find out.
I feel that, if we were going to talk about the movie, I really feel that one of the things that this movie does so well, and I give it credit to the director, Rob Savage, is they capture the awkwardness of the virtual meetings.
Yeah.
Because there are a couple lulls in, like, just the interaction, and lulls happen in a virtual world. It's so uncomfortable. It's not like just all sitting around and when you're in a meeting or something and you guys can all like chime in at the same time, but like virtual is always like, hey, I won't talk. I'm not gonna talk.
You had a few of those moments where they were all talking at once, and you're like, I can't, like, you can kind of follow, but you don't think you really meant to, because it was kind of it is that realism in a you know, a Zoom meeting or whatever.
Yeah.
And I do like the fact that in the very beginning, when it's just Gemma and Haley, and she's like, do you mind if I send some emails?
She's she's got other shit to do real quick.
She's like, go ahead. You know, I'm like, all right, I'm like, this is it. Like, I've been in those meetings where like, oh, we're just waiting for everybody to join. Let's all just, you know, just find something to do for 2 minutes kind of thing.
Yeah. And I love the way that it just marches forward. It just goes from like, oh, we're inviting people to the Zoom. Oh, somebody else is here. And then right into the story. And then they just basically introduce the characters as they come, as they enter the chat room or whatever, or the Zoom meeting.
Yeah. I was really kind of skeptical about this movie heading in, you know, based on premise alone. But then when I saw, I'm like, it's only 57 minutes.
How do you have a good movie?
But I think it actually helps with this movie. I mean, I know it's in the parameters of, you know, you can only have a certain length of Zoom call.
Yeah, Zoom for free was only 1 hour.
Unless you upgrade to pro version or whatever kind of shit like that. But I think, you know, it really helps in the fact that it kind of starts off a little slow as you're setting things up. But like, once everything starts happening, like, it keeps you throughout the rest of those 57 minutes.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, 50 out of those 57 minutes of the movie is actually there's stuff happening.
Yeah. It grabs your attention.
So I think it's really good. It worked in its favor for a movie like Host, where I think if you tried to make this an hour and a half on a fucking Zoom call, like,
that would have been hard.
Then you're getting into your own fucking, you know, you're at work basically in the same fucking meetings over and over again.
Yeah. But as we introduce all the characters, we kind of get little tidbits of backstory. Not very much. I mean, like Paul said, they go through the exposition pretty quickly where you're just meeting the friends. But I love when Raydina joins and then she goes back to talk to her boyfriend and she's just like, hold on. She just mutes everybody and they're talking about her. I was like, I just want them to turn around and be like, we can hear you guys. I didn't mute you.
Well, I'm pretty sure she put it on mute.
She
didn't want them to hear either. And I think that's one of the ways that it helps kind of, it creatively finds a way for you to get that exposition. Yeah. It's like, oh, well, they shouldn't have moved in together before.
If anything,
they didn't know each other that well before COVID. They shouldn't have moved in during the lockdown, like this and that. So it's like the little, you know, friend gossip kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like everyone would do. Cause that to me is like when you can have exposition in a way that presents itself as being super realistic,
like natural,
friends would say that, especially, you know, but
the relationship with Jenny when they meet Teddy's girlfriend or when they're talking about her, they all fucking hate Jenny. Well, they're all like, God damn it, Jenny.
The way they introduced everybody to me, it humanized everything. So it looks like, oh, okay, this is pretty much like Paul said, this is like everything you would see when you would see your friends getting together. Okay, you're gonna gossip about these people. You're gonna gossip about that. So to me, that humanized everybody. So it made everybody made a little bit more relatable and, like I said, humanized everybody.
Yeah, and I really like how the characters. I was like, I believe every one of these characters, because you're always going to have that one who just gets roped into the seances, who doesn't want to fucking do it, but she's there anyway, like Caroline.
Yeah, and they were such of like. Like a diverse group of friends, but you could still see them hanging out with each other. Like it wasn't like it was, you know, this girl is this type of character just for the sake of having that type of character.
Yeah.
They all were their own kind of characters and they all were different, but they all kind of meshed well. Like you could see them being friends.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't weird to be like, okay, why would they hang out with that girl?
Although I don't understand why Haley hangs out with Gemma. She clearly does not drive. She
apparently
with
has some issues with Gemma.
Yes.
I love how she's just pissed. And she's like, I'm feeling some disturbance. Like, she's just trying to get her attention. And she's like, fuck off. Fuck off, Gemma.
Yeah, there was a couple things that it pointed out to me that's like maybe there was more to it that was kind of just alluding to backstory. And I think definitely Gemma and Haley had some friction from something that's happened
Gemma's
before.
Gemma's the obviously. One who can take nothing seriously, and Haley's the one who likes to take everything seriously. She's the control freak. Yes.
I think that the dynamic between those two is they knew how to push each other's buttons, and they knew that, like with friends.
They're perfect friends. Yeah. Like we all have that friend that's just like fuck.
They were roommates in college, and they like to party, and then but then their competitive streak with grades and everything is what got them through everything. So
probably
that's why they were friends.
I can just see their normal friendship. Like you know, you have those friends to where you know you don't have to try a whole lot to push their buttons to piss them off. And that's how I felt Gemma was with Haley. She's like, yeah, I but know what I can do.
Haley's the one that always gets pissed off at everything. So you have to piss Haley off. Yeah. Like, that's what you gotta do. It's not Gemma's fault you had to piss Haley off.
Well, you can definitely tell because when Haley just, when they're in that lull for a minute and they kind of take a break and go pee and all that, when she comes back and she's like, fuck off, Gemma! I know, she does. Because she's like 0 to 60 and like,
fuck off, Gemma!
Flip of a switch. She's
well, beforehand, she's like, take it seriously. Salen's a friend of mine. Like, I just want you to take it seriously.
I love how Haley has that little moment with all of them before she calls Salen and tells him, hey, she's my friend. Mm-hmm. You all need to take this seriously because, again, this is my friend. Don't make me look bad.
And Teddy suggests that they all take shots anytime anybody hears astral plane. Yes.
All right. So we should probably start talking about the fucking movie.
We
this
are.
Podcast will be longer than the actual movie.
I know
movie.
It will. We're already a couple minutes in. So, but yeah, we are talking about
that. I do like that they integrated the, you know, the Zoom aspects in the beginning and the end of the movie with like the credits and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, the credits are my favorite part. The end credits where it's just listing everybody in the Zoom format. And I also love the added touch. It's in the beginning and at the end, but when they're clicking through things, you get the click noise.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, that puts me into, I'm on a computer. Like it automatically, I'm like, all right, I'm set up into my laptop for this fucking Zoom meeting, basically is what it is.
Yep.
But when I first saw this movie, those credits, I was like, that's fucking genius. Love it. I love it so much. But yeah, so Haley says, everyone take it seriously. And the rest of the group is doing shots, thanks to Teddy.
Well, yeah, he says the whole thing.
Wait. Okay. Teddy comes in and he immediately, and rightly so, gets made fun of about his man bun.
Oh, the twat knot?
As soon as I saw the man bun, I'm like, I hope this fucker dies alone for that damn man bun. And they even made fun of him in the movie for his man bun.
He made fun of it. Yes, he made fun of it. He says it's a COVID twat knot. So I'm just assuming he couldn't get a haircut before the filming of this film. And I give you credit. You called it a twat knot.
Twat knot.
A twat knot. Sorry.
A twat knot.
Well, I'm American, so we see twat.
With the twat knot.
It sounds grosser.
Twat knot.
Yes, exactly. There American. You go.
America twat knot.
America.
Ain't a man bun, it's a twat knot.
All right. There's so Teddy, I do like Teddy. I think he's hilarious. I do also think that this whole thing is his fault.
It is.
But anyway.
Caroline's dad flashed the camera, by the way.
He did. Oh, her dad. I forgot about Caroline's dad.
No, he's a pervert. That's why he keeps going outside. He's a flasher. I've got it all in my head. That's what it was.
He likes the sun on his chest, apparently.
He's a nudist, and he likes to go outside and flash children. That's why she held the laptop. No, she was on her phone. That's why she held her phone up higher because you couldn't see. He had no pants on, basically.
I loved Carolyn's character because she's such a staple in a friend group. We all had the terrified friend. Like, no matter what you were in, it was a terrified friend somewhere in there.
Was she into Teddy or was... Because she had the whole scene where she had this shit on her face, right? Where she was like, my pores are...
Yeah.
Terrible and lockdown or whatever, and they're like, oh, just to give you a heads up, Teddy's coming. She's like, oh, and she starts wiping all the stuff off. Is it more of like, I just don't want our guy friend to see me this,
maybe,
or was it like she in?
Yeah, because it didn't
well
seem
it made
like,
okay well it made sense that because they all fucking hated Jenny,
but Jenny was a bitch.
Well, how do you know she was a bitch?
Basically, she took her from her friends, man, and I believe
Jenny tried to save Ted's life, all right?
And I believe I agree with Gemma, who called her, she's such a fucking knob sack. She is a knob sack. You don't interrupt a seance just because you're jealous of him having friend time.
That really worked out well for them.
Yes.
It did not.
Okay. No. Okay. How about this? I'm going to throw this out. Where did the demon come from and whose fault was it?
Okay. The demon came from Gemma.
Yeah, Gemma
the introduced the G-Men, and she's the one who allowed it to come through because of her little story, right?
Yeah.
But okay. Teddy didn't sever when Salen's going around, and she was like, imagine yourself tied to a rope and tie that rope to your front door. And that way, if you need to get out.
You're tied to a rope?
Doing accents is not good. Tied to a rope? Nobody wants us to do accents.
I'm representing our Irish listeners.
Well, you're not, though. You're brown, dude. You're not representing.
You don't think there are brown people in Ireland?
No.
I don't think there's brown people in Ireland. No.
Brown papers.
Anyway, what was I saying?
Imagine the rope.
Oh, yeah. So Salen's like, imagine the rope. And Teddy did all that. He was there. He lit his candle.
How do you know he did that, though?
Because he was there for it.
He wasn't taking it seriously, though. So what makes you think he imagined all that?
Doesn't matter. Okay, fine. Even if he didn't imagine that, he was part of the circle.
Yeah.
He didn't exit from the circle in any ceremony kind of way. So they never closed the circle.
Yeah.
How do you know that, though?
Because Teddy didn't do anything.
Okay, I'm saying, how do you know that, though?
Because Teddy obviously didn't close it, or he would have come back and be like, are we not doing this? Okay, I closed it.
You're saying it's Gemma's fault for all that, and Teddy also aided in that, right?
Yeah.
Teddy's the reason.
Are you agreeing with this, or do you have...
I agree that it was Gemma's fault for letting the demon in. And when they all tried to sever it, obviously they couldn't sever it because the sixth person that was there when it first started and had that story thing going on wasn't there to be like in agreement with everybody else to sever it.
Yeah.
So when you have five doors closed and still one door open, he's going to come through the door that's open.
But then why wouldn't it just mess with the other... Or why wouldn't it just mess with Teddy then? He had the open door.
They wanted all of them. He wanted all of them. He got all of them too.
All right. First of all, we need someone who knows this shit. We should have had a witch on our show tonight to answer these fucking questions, all right? So if there are any witches...
We actually might know one.
Well, we did contact that one witch.
Yeah,
one time. But anyway, all right, I'm going to throw this on and let me see how this...
For good things, not for bad things.
No,
contact a witch for bad things.
No.
Yeah. Just so you're aware.
Yes.
Disclaimer.
We wanted to put a curse on a rival podcast. All right. All right, tell me if this floats your penis, all right?
All right.
Haley started this whole thing.
Yes.
And let's remember, it was her idea, okay? Yes. She started this whole thing in the very beginning of the fucking movie. How the fuck does her closet door just open?
I do think she was being haunted by something.
And also, she said when it was her and Gemma, Gemma's like, have you done this before? She's like, yeah, I've done it a few times. Stuff usually happens. So this is not her first time.
No.
So she's invited other shit. So how do we know that there wasn't something that was there with Haley already?
That just took up Gemma's?
That just like, oh, another open door. I can get the fuck out of here.
I can give you that
because
I do think Haley had some sort of a motive into wanting to put all these together. Because I'm like, I would never be like, hey, five friends, you want to do a seance over the internet with me? I just think that's a weird request to ask.
You could have literally, we're all going to watch a movie. We're all just going to talk and get drunk. Like, there's a million things you could have done on Zoom for an hour. Let's do a quick seance over the internet.
I do think that Haley had some sort of thing she wanted.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I do still think that it's Teddy's fault they couldn't close the door.
Okay, how about this, though? What about Teddy's story about the music box? And how it belonged to somebody.
It belonged to his brother because his brother was terrorized.
It belonged to their grandmother that died. And then he said, my brother used to move it all the time and hide it.
Yeah.
And then say it wasn't him. So how do we know there wasn't something already attached to his box? And that's maybe what it was.
It could have just been a bunch of undertones.
So that's what I'm telling you. There's no clear suspect in this. And I think there could be so many different avenues that a demon or something could have taken.
Yeah.
That I don't think that it's any one person's fault, but it's definitely there's little things that each of them did that to probably, make it worse for each other.
It was cumulative.
Fine.
Okay.
I'll give you guys all that.
Actually, it's Jenny's fault. She's the one that did it.
It is Jenny's fault. Yeah. She's the one who just blipped them out there, man.
Witch!
But Salen comes on and she's like, okay, everybody, respect the spirits.
No.
And each other.
She says spirit, and it's so annoying when you watch. She's like, hello, spirit? Or she's like, maybe the spirit? And I'm like, say spirits.
Again, I don't know why Paul keeps doing these accents, guys. I apologize. Yeah. It's just, I don't know.
Don't be jealous.
Anyway, I'm white. I could probably do these better than you.
Do it. The gauntlet has been thrown down.
No.
No, you can't talk shit and then not back it up.
I'm respectful. Anyway. So she tells them, cord around your waist, to your door, cut it when done, blah, 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 blah.
Cord around your waist.
Mm-hmm. I love how Salem's like, we could be possessed and that's not a bad thing. I'm like, no, yeah, I'm honey, that's like, a bad thing.
Like, when is possessed not a bad thing is what I wrote down.
It that's just
like,
means the one thing that I thought they're too, here. Is like, when she no, said that. No, yeah, possessed like, no. means... Like somebody's penetrated yes. my spirit, and I don't want that to happen. No like, penetration Ceylan, needs to happen during a séance.
Ceylan's trying to convince them that it's like fucking Ghost, where they all go to visit Oda Mae Brown, and they get into her body, and like,
damn, you, baby, what'd you do? What'd you do to your hair, baby?
No, that's not what happens in real life. Do not. Okay, I want no one in my body at all. I'm yes. no spirits. No, like no I spirit. Said,
there will be it's no not penetration.
Be Patrick Swayze and Demi Moore. Yes. And no penetration of my spirit. Loved in the background.
I'm sorry. My body is exit only for the astral plane.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Drink.
I do love how they're like, can I contact a dog? Because who the fuck are you going to contact, yeah. man? Nobody wants to actually talk to their dead relative.
Okay. It's funny, though, that those questions really were, I'm like, those are valid questions.
They were.
Like,
yeah.
is there, there's no language barrier on the astral planes. I'm like, all right, well, I guess that answers that question. And I'm like, can we talk to a dog? I'd be like, what the fuck would you talk to your dog about? And like, what if you talk to your dog and you're like, oh, Skippy, I miss you so much. And he's like, why did you have sex in front of me all of those times? Do you know how fucking scarring that is?
Like, that's traumatizing. I thought you were being attacked.
Why did you stand there and stare at me while it happened? I thought you were being attacked.
What is that smell?
Gross.
We don't want to know what our animals would say to us.
No.
Don't contact your animals. Horror PSA, don't contact your dead
exactly.
animals.
Exactly. I do love Gemma's performance, though. It's dramatic. It's profound. She performs. Like, yes. she screams. She was like, she starts to cry. She's like, yeah. he's a kid from school. He hung himself.
What was the kid's name? Was it?
I don't remember.
David?
I don't Brandon? Recall. I don't recall. Yeah. Jack.
Jack.
It was Jack. Jack. I think it was something Jack. Like that. Yeah, it was something simple. But yeah, and then right as something happens.
Wait, you should have known her story was bullshit. She's like, well, I cracked my head open. I'm like, bitch, you didn't crack your fucking head open. What the Why? Fuck are you talking
we
about?
We all crack our heads yeah. open every now and then.
No, because when you say I cracked my head open and he helped pick me up.
Well, maybe that means something okay, different no. in the UK versus.
Well, okay, fine. But it was like, you cracked your fucking head open, then you just got up and walked away.
And
like,
he just picked me up and. Like, I went about my day.
Like, oh, that's why you can't, you have no cognitive reasoning left.
I love that the first kind of creepy thing that happens, though, is when Haley is pissed about the performance and yeah. she's screaming yeah. at Gemma. And then it just like all the practical effects in this movie, I fucking live for them. I love practical effects. And we did a Twitter thing with the director, and it really was just somebody pulling Haley with a chair.
It was Haley's so boyfriend. Was.
Yeah. Just pulling Haley's her across
boyfriend,
the room on that chair.
Like, around the corner in the hall, and I think they just tied a rope, and he just
yanked it.
Yeah, and it fucking works, though, because the first time you just see her sliding back, you're like, holy fuck, nope, mm-mm.
See,
I don't
and
even
care. That's when I started getting the Paranormal Activity vibes from it.
Mm. See, when I had that happen, I'm like, okay, Haley needs to move. That's just what needs to happen. She's got to yep. find a new place to live. We got to get out of this place. But they all start freaking out. I love how it's just zero to freak out. And they're yeah. all like, what do we do? We don't know what to do. They're like call Salem, call her. Because Salem's blipped out at this point. Her internet apparently has gone down, which again is something that happens in the Zoom world. We've all had yeah, somebody just blip out and just gone forever.
If you're going to do online seances, like it probably should have like really good fucking internet.
Yeah.
So, you know, not just that though.
You're not kicked out and you can't close the loop or whatever.
That's the one thing that I'm like, again, my issues and my problems with it were a lot of the tropes, because you see them having the seance and all of a sudden I was like, okay, at some point the lady holding the seance is going to lose connection and they're not going to be able to get a hold of her.
And but, that happened. Okay, how about this though? Let me throw this on you. What if Salem got killed too and you just didn't see it?
That could have happened.
Because her internet cuts out is one thing, right? So maybe the demon's like, I'm going to cut that out and then these people are defenseless.
But they
don't
do call her.
At me. Okay, but they call her on the phone, but then it gets disconnected at one mm-hmm. point, and then when they call her back, she's like, she's not answering.
No, I was going to say that when she blips out, they all hear something and Salem turns around to look behind her.
Yeah.
Because she hears yeah. something behind her because I caught yeah. it. When it's right before she blips, she hears a noise and she turns.
It was yeah. her cat.
Probably. It could have been another delivery because she got food delivered halfway through the beginning of the seance.
Yes. A bottle of tahini.
Yes. But I love when they get her on the phone and she's just like, okay, Gemma, have we tried asking if it's your friend Jack? And Haley's like, I don't know, Gemma. Did we ask if she's
Did we ask if it's like, Jack?
I love that because that's a friend thing. Like, yep.
This is your fault.
This is not the first time that Haley has taken that tone with Gemma.
No, not at all. But Carolyn, actually, before they get a hold of Salen again, Carolyn does the selfie stick up into her attic, and I love that part. It creates so much tension just in her, like, getting at the stairs and just focusing on that little fucking ladder thing that comes out. Like, the tension built in that spot. And I love how she turns around and goes to her junk drawer in her room to find her selfie stick. Yep, not going up there. I'll put the selfie stick up there. And I support that decision, Carolyn. Like, I really do.
You guys tell me what's up there.
Yep, you guys see. And then just the 2 feet hanging. It's so simple, but it's so effective.
Yes.
It's so creepy.
Plus, okay, the one thing about that part that I was like, she kind of passed it and had to go back. I'm like, are you serious? Like, I know that she had to do that for the effect for them to, you know.
Yeah, but she wasn't looking.
I know she wasn't looking, but I'm saying her friends were watching it. And how come none of them were like, stop right there. Oh, my God. What the fuck?
Like, well, they were all like, what is that?
Yeah.
What is that? Go back. And then that's by the time she moved. So, again, that delay in relaying information is hard on Zoom. Yes. Like, because there's always going to be that little delay. There's always going to be, it's not as fluid as a normal conversation would be.
You shouldn't be having fucking seances.
Yeah, that should just be the whore PSA this
don't
week.
Don't do seances. Like,
there's there's a million reasons. Like, on the internet. Like, just, there's a lot of stuff.
No.
Like, if my internet craps out, then I'm stuck with an open door because I can't get back up. What if there's an internet outage? I mean,
nobody wants to have just Elvis sitting in their living room for 6 hours because you can't figure out how to get the rest of your team back together to close this door, right? Like, nobody wants that.
Making fried banana sandwiches and shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's eating all my food and singing songs. Elvis,
you're just dead.
Like, please leave.
But then after Gemma finally nuts up and reveals that the story was fake to Salen. Salen's like, look, guys, I fucking told you. I fucking told you not to do this. I said, respect the spirits. And now we have something that could have climbed in just on the story alone.
Yeah.
I
love that she gave her disclaimers in the beginning, like, well, since we're doing this online, it's a bit more risky, blah, blah, blah. We're not as protected. So I'm like, so instead of one door, you made them open 6 or whatever?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then they're like, okay, let's shut it down. Salen's like, let's shut it down. Let's ask it some questions and then get it out of here. So they start asking it questions and it progressively, like, I think it screams at Haley. Yeah. Doesn't it, like, turn all of her lights on or something?
The first question, the lights flicker or whatever. And then it's like the second one, it's like the lights came on and, like, almost like, I don't know if the bulbs exploded or what. It doesn't look like it got, like, super bright and, like, washed out really quick. And then
they did that one thing where they said, do one knock for yes and 2 knocks for no.
Oh, yeah. And they asked it if it was friendly and it resoundingly said no.
Yes.
So that's when I believe they lose Salen on the phone. Yeah,
that's when they lose her. So pro tip, if you're ever, you know, talking to an evil spirit or whatever, be like, one is yes, 55 for no. So you have time to get the fuck out of there. Because if it's more than one, you're like, are you friendly? It's like, like, all right, I have 53 more to get the fuck out of here real quick.
Mm-hmm. Yep, no thank you. And that's me. If I was yelling at somebody on my computer and my ass just slid across the floor with a chair,
really, I'm done.
No I'm more. Going to a Starbucks. I don't even care if they make me wait outside. I'll do that. I'm staying at that house. That's not me.
Nope. You're like, I'm coming back during the day.
Yep, exactly. Exactly.
I don't think the one thing we do have to mention is at some point Teddy does leave this because his girlfriend pulls the bitch move and steals him away for whatever reason.
Yes, during the beginning of the seance. Like, he didn't even get into the seance. He just basically he was there for the circling gathering. Light the candle, and then his girlfriend was like, bye, guys, and literally hangs up because she's clingy. Don't be clingy.
Yes.
Let your boy have friends. They need friends.
No, not if they're doing a seance online. Then no, you shut that shit down.
I suppose. You if shut doing that shit down seance. Because
it's 1 for yes, 55 for no.
55 for no.
Get the fuck out of there.
The thing that I told Kim, as soon as Teddy got disconnected, I'm like, he's going to get it the worst because he's not having any idea of what's coming.
Mm-hmm. And they all start freaking out. Like,
the demon should have hung him up by his twat knot.
His twat knot.
Yes.
Emma, when that glass explodes and she's just like, what the fuck just happened? I'm like, if something exploded in my room, I wouldn't be in the room.
No battle.
I'm like, I don't know. You all are fucking brave or stupid or something, but I
where are you going to go, Angie? It was in a lockdown.
I just told you. I would stand outside a fucking Starbucks. I don't give any
fuck. She does go outside later and that doesn't really work out for her. So.
Well, she doesn't actually go outside. She falls outside.
Well, she goes outside on her own first and then she's...
No, Emma, not Gemma. Emma.
I'm talking about Emma.
When does she go outside?
When she opens her sliding glass door and starts walking outside, and then she gets taken.
Yeah.
Does she?
Boom. Now, since you won't do an Irish accent, let me hear your Elvis.
Well, Elvis isn't an accent. That's just a person and an impersonation.
Well, he was from Mississippi.
I'm not doing voices, Paul. Today is not the day.
You're going to talk shit, then you're going to do something.
No, I'm just saying don't do them because nobody likes them.
Until I hear otherwise, everybody loves them.
But Caroline's computer, earlier in the thing, she shows them this magical thing she's made where that it's basically loop. A save scream. Yeah, it's basically a save scream loop of her. Like, just in the background doing stuff.
Which I knew as soon as I saw that, like, that's going to play back into something. Mm-hmm.
So, wait. She was on her computer, then how did she use that stupid little selfie stick?
Well, I think she switched it.
Yeah.
I think she picked up her phone at one point and just took it with her and then switched it back when she goes back into the room.
Yeah.
I think that's what happened, but don't quote me on that.
So, we all knew that thing was going to, the screensaver thing was going to come up again, but we all still forgot about it.
Yeah.
For a few seconds.
But Caroline, that thing is on, and then her computer falls, and they're like, what was that?
No,
but
her computer didn't fall.
Well.
Her head got hit against it.
Her head got hit against it.
And her stupid friends that don't pay attention to shit were like, I think her computer fell.
I know. And then, well, that was because that was like after they come back from the break, I thought. Or maybe
well,
not.
She leaves, and they're like, oh, she's come back. And like, no, wait a minute. That's that loop thing that she had. And then that's when it fell.
Yeah. And so, like, they're all around because they've shut the... They all think that they've shut it.
They all think they
shut the door. Yeah. They all thought Haley shut the door, but they have not. So Carolyn's computer, something goes on with that. And then Raydina can't find her man. She's just looking for everywhere. But
after she takes a shit while everyone has to watch.
Yes. But then poor Emma. She finds a face with her filter in her living room.
That was creepy.
It's so creepy, right? Because we all have been there. We've all been looking at through the filters. Like, if I just saw a face right now. We've all scared ourselves with that shit, okay?
Because it's just sitting there and they yell at her. It's like, take your filter off. And then all of a sudden you see her get close to it. And then when it turns and it looks at her.
Yeah, the turning and looking is what it's like, oh no, that's bad. Yep, I'm out. And then she gets the fucking flower and she's sprinkling the flower. No, bitch, no. You don't need to see that. Like, you just saw something. Look at you. Get the
Why
fuck out.
Why did the blanket work, but not the flower?
What do you mean?
Well, later she throws the blanket over and it sticks to the guy's, you know, the demon's head or whatever.
Yeah. Right?
And it makes the silhouette or whatever.
So what are you saying didn't work with the flower?
When she threw the flower, it didn't like stick to the top of the fucking demon's head or whatever.
She threw it on the ground.
Yeah, I just thought
no,
it on
she
the ground.
Threw it up like that and then didn't see anything and then started throwing it down.
Oh, well, I didn't notice that.
Did you guys watch the fucking movie like, at all?
Yes.
Paul thinks he's special because he remembers stupid details that nobody cares about. Anyway.
Sorry. Remember the movie that we're talking about. We should be nice.
But even after that, the flower on the floor, but nobody know.
Yep, you see the feet on the floor,
And then her kitchen has a fit.
Yes.
And then she goes and hides under a blanket. And although I do think that is really dumb, I do really appreciate the fact that that blanket, like, held on. Like, she survived at least 15, 20 minutes longer because she was under that blanket.
Yeah. Watching this movie multiple times, like, the last time I watched this movie, I was secretly like, all right, and now the demon goes to this one. He's like, all right, I've got her in the blanket, so she's not going anywhere. I can run over here real quick and take care of this and then come back to her.
Do you think he's time management?
Oh, yeah, he is. Like, he's like, I got to get all of them. Wisely, I got to get all of them. That's why he picked the right moments where he's like, oh, they're all arguing right now. I'm going to pull on fucking Haley's chair right now and freak them all the fuck out.
Mm-hmm.
This was all about time management. He was like, holy crap, six at once and they're all different places.
I can do this.
Challenge accepted.
Yeah, like, but I can do this. The kitchen, this demon hates kitchens. Yeah. He really does not like kitchens.
The demon was like, fuck your kitchen.
Fuck your kitchen. But Caroline, they finally see Caroline's face is smashing into her computer over and over. And
repeatedly.
I think she just says, help me. And that's her last line.
She's like, yeah, I'll bet.
Yeah, all bloody. All gross. And then Emma is fucking under her blanket just sobbing. Like, she's just, oh, God, guys, oh, my God. She's just so out of it. And then Teddy comes back. not knowing any fucking thing.
And with he's his like, creepy-ass puppet.
With his creepy-ass puppet. And he calls them a bunch of fat bitches, doesn't he?
Yes.
And then he immediately gets repercussions because you don't call your friends fat bitches. That's
I
not said, nice.
As soon as I saw him come back, I'm like, he's going to get it the fucking worst. And then that's when everything had gone down. He does the creepy puppet thing.
It's time
and
you
then,
get yours, Teddy.
Yes. And then like all the lights go out and he starts going outside to try to find the circuit breaker or whatever. Yeah. And Emma's like, it's not a circuit breaker.
She did such a good job of just being like that. Like
he did.
Like that one for like, what are you saying?
And then for the rest of it, she's just like, Teddy, get out. Teddy, get out. But I love it because Teddy's just like, da, da, da. And then you see his girlfriend get it, which we were all hoping we would see Jenny go. And oh, she was did.
Just hanging above got her neck snap.
Yeah, she did. Like,
he was hanging above the pole and then just drops him. Yeah.
And again, it's a little effect that just works so great. It's a little special effect that just works so well. You don't need a lot. And that's what I really feel this film does well. It's not heavy handed in any one area.
Yeah.
It's nicely displayed throughout the whole thing.
I honestly don't know where they could have put another 30 minutes in this movie and not made it worse.
Yeah. Like,
I really think the runtime works for what this movie is.
Mm-hmm. But then, Teddy goes outside and he finds that music box, and that ain't good to find the music box.
See, the music box is moving on its own all along.
And then his dumbass decided to use what his lighter does. See,
so see, I want a prequel to where all these people had demons around them the whole time and they never know. Mm-hmm. And then for some reason, like these six doors open at the same time. And then, you know, that's what got into it. These demons are like, let's swap. This is fun. It's like if Drop Dead Fred switched, you know, with other
imaginary friends. They're just tag-teaming everybody, like, yeah.
All right, yeah, it's literally the... Okay, God damn it. Emma, I want to go back to the flower thing real quick. Like, okay, the flower thing worked and the thing stepped on it. I'm like, okay, so from now on, my horror PSA is throw a sack of flour with tacks in it, you know, because if that fucking thing's going to walk through, they're like, all right, well, you know, either you're going to stay there or you're going to step on this motherfucker.
Home alone.
And at least that one had feet and not like you were saying the paranormal activity, because that one had hooves. Yeah. And the thumbtack, nothing's going to fuck up the hooves. It's just going to go in the hoof thing. But like feet. All right.
So if it's a demon, then I want a bunch of like tiny crucifixes and flower and crucifixes. Like the size of jacks.
Get some holy water, make a paste. You got it.
Crucifix jacks. That's it. Crucifix jacks.
That's it. Stick up when you lay them down. Yes.
And the holy nets. That's all we need.
The holy nets. Yes. But one by one, all the girls and Teddy come to their death.
Yes.
Raydina's boyfriend actually gets it as well. He falls to his death from the ceiling somewhere.
I know. Yeah, they have like a two-story? Yeah. He was just hanging on the ceiling the whole time.
I don't know. But apparently he falls to his death. Raydina is picked up and then dropped to her death, right? Yes. Same thing. Emma was pushed out the window.
Emma was picked up a couple times.
Yeah, Emma was picked up a couple times.
She tried to book it, and she got caught outside and got thrown up and down a few times.
Yeah. Haley is hiding because there was some shit happening in her house. She saw somebody. Yeah,
she got pulled into the closet or that other set.
Well, she got pulled into that room or whatever after she took that Polaroid of the demon that was
hanging or whatever.
Why the fuck didn't she get out? Like, I was under the impression like something had happened to her, you know? Like,
why did none of them get out?
She was like knocked out or something. And then fucking Gemma is like quick with the B&E and just fucking goes in and is like, Haley, let's get the fuck out of here.
She fucking breaks.
And then she gets that bottle like just bump right in the side. Yep. I laugh every time I see that. I don't know why. It's just so funny to me.
Like, she's just standing. It's just so unexpected. Like, boop.
Like, Haley, it's a full on bottle to the head moment. And you're just kind of like, fuck.
It's literally like, Haley, where are you? Like, boom.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love how Gemma breaks into her apartment. She just grabs her mask, like, fuck this. I'm going to go break into her apartment real quick. And then they see each other and give each other COVID elbows. Yes.
I'm like, bitch, get the fuck out. Don't be COVID elbows.
We don't need
shit.
COVID elbows. There's a demon in here, bitches. Get out of the apartment.
Get out.
Where do you go, though? How do you explain it? Maggie, the worst thing that could happen to any one of these characters is if one of them lived. And how would you explain the deaths of everyone else without anyone thinking you're fucking crazy?
I don't know. And exactly. I love when Haley's kitchen has a fit and Emma or Gemma's in there and she's like, fuck you! Like, she just gets so
fuck
mad.
Fuck this kitchen!
Fuck you, demon! Like, here again, my friend. But then
fuck me, fuck me up this bitch.
The thing again that Rob Savage, the director, did so well with the tension and using all these little things to his advantage was the countdown.
Yeah.
Every time I watch this movie, I can't help but keep looking at the countdown and keep looking on screen. I'm like, oh my god, something's gonna happen.
Even notice that.
Like, yeah, it starts to. It's like you're almost to the hour, and then the countdown starts in the corner, and I'm so like on the edge of my seat.
I remember seeing the prompt come up that you're almost out of time, but I didn't notice the countdown in the corner.
Yeah, I have to watch it. Now. Yeah, it does. It even has the switch to the pro thing, and it's like, oh, but yeah, as it builds up, like you're just so ready for it because you know at any moment it's gonna cut out.
Yep.
And then it just that you get that last jump scare, and even though it's a cheesy demon, I still am into it. I still dig it.
That's the one thing that I'm like, I wish there was the, I don't know, the ending I think could have been better. Like, you get that it's going to be that, you know it's happening. And like I said, there's nothing original about this movie. It's just, it's presented in, you know, a unique way.
Yes.
Yeah.
But still, I'm like, if they would have had something better than just that jump scare demon face as it cuts out, like every found footage fucking movie always fucking has.
Not true. I mean, it could have just had the girl staring into a corner of a blank wall, just like Blair Witch Project.
Okay, which will still be a better ending than the stupid cut.
I highly disagree.
I don't know.
I do not like ambiguous endings.
Would you have ended it other than that? Because, like, I mean, yeah, it's a trope, but really, how else would you have ended it other than that?
I don't know. You could have. Done. I mean, besides the Blair Witch ending, you mean?
Yeah.
I don't know. You get Haley's possessed, and she comes after Gemma.
Boo. Done. Been okay, done.
But it's all been done. I'm saying you said differently.
That's why I don't mind that jump scare, the final jump scare. I don't mind it because it's still, it's in theme with the rest of the movie, because I believe you see the demon one other time somewhere.
You see him a couple times when Teddy's getting away. Because when Teddy, I think he falls or he gets pushed, and it's like he's laying on his back and you see the angle, like you see all his legs.
Yeah.
And then he's kind of looking around with the flashlight. And then he shines it, and the demon there, like, kind of jumps out of it or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
And then when he runs, so I think there might have been a couple of little glimpses of that, but I think it's the only two times that I remember that you really, really see his face and all that.
Yeah, and see, I don't mind those, especially in ghost movies. I don't need to see everything. Ghost demon movies, like, most of the time you don't, so I'm okay with it. So maybe that's why it didn't bother me. And I just, the ending never really bothers me because then I'm just so like, ooh, look at these pretty credits at the end.
I guess.
I really enjoy the end.
It could have had a better
ending. All right. Well,
it could have just cut out and then you don't know what the fuck happens.
Well, is that your final thought, Paul? Because we went through this whole movie in 40 some minutes. So, final thoughts, guys.
We should have just watched the movie.
We could have. We could have did a watch along.
Who wants to go first?
This movie. I think I've said all I need to say about this movie. It's good. It's not great. Don't go into it expecting it to be great and amazing. Know that you've seen the tropes before. Know that it's, you know, an updated version with a little bit of a kind of a different take on some of the same things. And if you haven't seen the movie, then we already spoiled the fucking ending for you. So.
Go watch it. It's on Shudder.
I do want to point out that I do love that this was created, you know, in the pandemic and because of the pandemic.
Yeah.
Because it really is, I think, you know, creative people are going to be creative no matter what. You put parameters on them, they still find a way to make creativity work. I think, you know, it just, this kind of environment that we're in, there's so many different people that are finding different ways to be creative, whether it's on TikTok or short films and stuff. This movie actually was a short film where he pranked his friends during, you know, a Zoom call like this, and had, you know, shit happen to him, and, you know, he didn't tell them that it was, you know, he was pretending and doing all this stuff.
That might be what it's like to be friends with me.
So they, I guess, you know, he filmed it all and, you know, pranked his friends. They had no clue, and, you know, he put it on social media or something, and it went viral. So when that got kind of going, he contacted Shudder and was like, hey, here's this thing that I made. I'd like to turn this into a, you know, feature-length movie. And they got on board with it after seeing all that. And, you know, he's directed before, so, you know, he'd gotten some experience and everything. So it's definitely, it's a good movie. It's not great, but it's good, and it's fresh and original, and you'll have a good time with it.
just to add to what you were saying before Saul does his final thoughts, Shudder and a lot of people are really doing great things with indie horror these days. They're really being supportive for artists who are, you know, independent and have really great ideas and just want to. The Horror Collective is also another one that's coming out with new stuff. And I'm really happy that all of our creative horror people are finding new homes and new ways to do things.
Yes.
But Saul, final thoughts on Host.
This movie wasn't bad for what it was. I feel like if you're a fan of the Paranormal Activity type genre, you'll enjoy this. But like Paul said, don't go into it expecting something like breathtakingly new. It's been done before. My issues were a lot of the tropes from the Paranormal Activity movies were in this. If you can see outside of those, then enjoy this movie for what it was, especially getting that creative outlet out, especially during the COVID era and how they did it. It was a really good idea. Like, the way they did it, the way they presented it, actually drove you into it, grabbed your attention, and kept it throughout it. The 57-minute runtime seems short, but it's perfect for what it was.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it felt, like, shortened at all. I think we got the whole story in the 57 minutes. I don't think that anything was lost keeping it that short. But my final thoughts are, I really enjoy the setup of this film. I really did not think that I was going to like it at all, but it does feel like a horror movie for the era we're living in. And that's always interesting to see when people do new things like this, because horror is never going to be the most imaginative genre. It just isn't. Right? That's not what people come to horror to look like most often.
Oh, you shut your mouth.
But this horror movie and its idea was done really well. I really enjoyed not only the practical effects, but the storyline that they gave these girls. And the girls are all their own independent characters. I didn't feel like they all overlapped in any kind of way. They weren't your typical trope women in horror movies. No. I mean, Emma did ball the whole time, but she was having some things happen to her, so I forgive her for that.
Everybody has that one friend. Yeah.
But I really enjoyed that all of these girls stood on their own. They all died on their own too, but I liked all the characters. I didn't hate anyone except for the ones I was supposed to hate, Jenny.
Yeah.
Why would you hate Jenny? What did she do to anybody?
She took Teddy from his friends.
Yes.
We've all had that happen.
Yes.
We've all had that one friend who got a girlfriend or a boyfriend. You're just like, that fucking dick won't let them hang out with us for no other reason other than they're just a dick.
Yes.
Again, you're basing this off of the online seance and not other things.
Yes. Fair enough. Maybe Jenny gets a bad rap. But anyway, I love this movie. It's a great one for 2020. Like I said earlier, I thought it was going to be way dumb, but it was not. So it pleasantly surprised me with how not stupid it was.
Yes.
And I actually enjoyed this film. It's one I could put on and watch again and again. So it's always a good thing when it comes to ghost movies. I don't know. I'm a weird one who could put ghost movies on at any time. Like Easter, I can watch The Conjuring. It doesn't bother me. But yeah. That's all.
Are you saying you're not supposed to be watching The Conjuring during Easter?
People have told me I'm not supposed to, but who knows?
Who cares?
I don't know those people.
Yeah, I don't need that kind of negativity in my life, is for sure. So maybe they shouldn't be in my life, but anyway.
At the same time, I don't want to fuck your kitchen demon in my house.
I don't want to fuck your kitchen demon.
Where do you draw the line?
I don't. My kitchen does not need to be having a fit, because I'm like, I wouldn't even clean that fucking up. I'd be like, this is not my mess.
I am.
You know how many times I've had to clean this kitchen? I didn't do this mess. It wasn't me, especially after fucking COVID quarantine. We're all cooking and shit. Fuck that. No, I'm not cleaning up that kitchen. You better just kill me. Mess up my kitchen. But that's it for this week, guys. I think next week we are coming back with New Mutants.
Yeah. Okay. I thought we were doing New Mutants.
I don't know what we're doing.
I'm excited. I'm kind of excited, and I don't know what to expect from that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll talk about it next week.
Yeah, but next week we'll be back with another 2020, even though it was technically a 2018. Maybe it was probably
2017.
2017, they filmed it for
sure. In 2017.
But anyway, it finally came out this year. So New Mutants, we will be doing next week. We want to do a shout out real quick to my group, the Awesome Geek Headquarters, who are very supportive of the Horror PSA. You guys should check out the group and come for other nerdy fun things. I post on there. Lots of other people post. It's a fun little group. It's on Facebook if you want to enjoy it. But that's it for this week. You guys can check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can support us on Patreon by going to patreon.com/scarynerd. You can email us for stickers or any comments, questions, concerns at podcast@scarynerd.com. And we will see you guys next week with the New Mutants. Anything else, guys?
No. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Happy Spookies.